Alrighty then. Give that a try right there. Try something different today. Supposed to be doing my show today, Devoted to Y'all Radio, but I can't because Skype is acting funny. Skype and Windows. So I updated Windows, updated Skype, and now my Skype keeps shutting off. I don't even use it anymore now for fellowship. I've been using Google Hangouts. So unfortunately, I can't do my radio show without Skype. So for now, I guess I'll be using this until I fix whatever's going on so I can get back and do my radio show. But since I'm not going to do the radio show, I'm going to do my my little notes on the studies that I did for Yisrael from the book of Matthew to the book of Acts. And we could probably even go past the book of Acts. And that's what this video is going to be about. So if you want to share this video with anyone, go right ahead, copy and paste it. If you want, copy the words, copy the scriptures that I'm sharing. It's real simple. All I'm doing is looking up the word Israel in a word search on my scripture app. Or the good old-fashioned way would be to get a Strong's Concordance book and look up the word Israel and look at all the scriptures that show up for it in the New Testament, or the Brit Hadashah, as we say. So share this with Christians. This is going to be a word study on the word Israel from the book of Matthew to the book of Acts. And again, we'll probably go by past the book of Acts. All right, so here we go. Let's go. Matthew chapter 2. Verses 1 to 6, and I'm using, I'm reading the WEB version of the Bible, just to let you know, but I am going to be using some Hebrew names, especially with the Messiah and the Father. So, Matthew chapter 2, verse 1 to 6, it says, "Now, after Yahusha was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east to Yerushalayim, saying, where is he that is born king of Yehuda?" Okay. King of who? King of Judah. Very important. It doesn't say, where is the king of the Christians? Where is the king of the kingdom of Christianity? You can't get that. Where is he that is born king of Yehuda, Judah? For we have seen his star in the east and have come to worship him. When Herod the king had heard these things, he was troubled, and all Yerushalayim with him. And when he had assembled all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah would be born. The word Messiah is connected with kingship. It's a king. It's a kingly title. It's a anointed. Somebody who's anointed to be king. That's the context why they're using the word Messiah. Almost like Pharaoh. Pharaoh is a position of a king of Egypt. That's not the name of the person. That's the title that they're carrying. They're a Pharaoh. In this case, it's Messiah, and that's the Hebrew title for the person who is a king. And so far, we're seeing the king of Judah, the king of Yehuda. So he's asking where the Messiah would be born. And they said to him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for thus it is written by the prophet, 'And thou, Bethlehem, in the land of Judea, art not the least among the princes of Yehuda. For out of thee shall come a governor," or a ruler in some translations it would say, "that they," a ruler "that shall rule," or shepherd, some translations say, which I like better, that shall shepherd my people, Yisrael. Once again, we have the king of Yehuda, and now we have the prophecy of Micah chapter 5 verse 2, Genesis 49:10, Numbers 24:19, 1 Chronicles chapter 5 verse 2, Psalm chapter 2 verses 1 to 6, Isaiah chapter 9 verse 6 to 7. We have this prophecy. Here we go. A governor, a ruler, a shepherd that's going to shepherd my people, Yisrael. So many Christians celebrate Christmas. They celebrate the birth of the Messiah. But they ignore completely the identity of the Messiah and the identity of his sheep, of his people, of his pasture, which is Israel. Not many Christians will say that they are Israel, and rightfully so. And we can go all day about that. If you're not really following the Messiah and what he commanded, you're obviously not his people. I don't want to go on a tangent. I'm trying my best to stay focused, but I can't help myself. Yisrael, he's the king of Yisrael. I mean, how do you celebrate Christmas? Okay, this is where I was going. Replacement theology. There are Christians who claim that the Christian church replaces Israel and now is the spiritual Israel. That's not true. Say that replacement theology is saying that us Christians who are Gentiles and a mixture of Gentiles and Jews, we don't have to keep all the commandments and laws that the Israelites had to keep. That's where they're wrong. I do believe in a remnant or a spiritual Yisrael. I do believe in that. I do. I believe that me today, even though I don't know if I'm an original Israelite or not, I believe that through the Messiah, having faith in him, in his death and his resurrection and his purpose and the message that he preached, believing in him, immersing myself in his name, Yahusha, that's what I believe his name is. You can watch other videos on my YouTube page to learn about that. But being immersed in his name, I'm being immersed in his character. I'm being immersed in his teachings. I'm immersed in what he taught. And according to Matthew chapter 23, verses 1 to 3, he actually commanded his disciples to keep the law of Moses. So with that being said, I mean, there is no such thing as a spiritual Israel that doesn't obey the law of Moses. That's not a message that the Messiah came to preach. So, yes, he came to be a king and a shepherd of Yisrael. But Yisrael is filled with a remnant of people who are faithful and obedient to the commandments of the Messiah to the best of their ability. Obviously, to whom much is given, much is required. Okay? We'll keep going. But so far, I mean, right off the bat, I mean, this is the reason why he was coming to the earth to be born, okay? To manifest himself as the messianic king of Israel. It's beautiful. Matthew chapter 15, verse 21 to 28. Then Yahusha went thence and departed into the territories of Tyre and Sidon. And behold, a woman of Canaan came out of the same territories and cried to him, saying, Have mercy on me, O master, thou son of David. My daughter is grievously afflicted with a demon. So right off the bat, guys, this is a woman from Canaan. So she's obviously a Gentile. She's a Canaanite, okay? And a daughter of hers has a demon, and she's going to the right person. Verse 23, but he answered her not a word. He ignored her. And his disciples came and besought him, saying, send her out of here. Send her away, for she cries after us. But he answered and said, I am not sent but to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Huge, huge words here. And I'm not taking anything out of context. This is what he said. This is his purpose. It's coming for the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Now, context to this, if you follow me on the Two House Restoration study that I'm doing on YouTube, or just Google search it, follow somebody, check somebody out. There's articles out there. It's not new. The Two House Restoration of Israel. Read the content of this message from Genesis to Revelation. Check it out. The storyline falls in harmony with everything that's been written since the beginning. You know, progressively from Adam all the way to Jacob, the father, Yahuwah, I call him, Yahuwah, was progressively pointing forward to a chosen kingdom, a chosen nation of people. Okay? Yes, Abraham wasn't an Israelite. Noah wasn't an Israelite. There was no such thing as an Israelite then, but they were chosen and faithful and righteous people. But that's because it was progressively pointing forward to the promise that he's going to set apart a people to himself. And he's going to be their Elohim, and they're going to be his people. He's going to be their shepherd. He's going to be their king. All of it points forward, and the climactic period happens when Jacob's name is changed to Yisrael. His 12 sons from that point forward are representative of the chosen people. Okay? And then within those people are the real chosen people, the remnant. Okay? Those who actually obey, because you have a lot of physical Israelites who are stiff-necked and rebellious and stubborn. But we're talking about the remnant. There's only a remnant of Israel that can be saved. Now, along with that story, there were Gentiles that lived amongst those Israelites. You'll see this all throughout the Tanakh, the Pentateuch, the Old Testament, as you might say. You'll see this whole storyline happening, where you'll see Gentiles living among them, strangers, okay? A mixed multitude coming out of Egypt. It's nothing new. They lived amongst the Israelites, and they were to be treated as an Israelite, as a native born. They were to have the same laws, the same commandments. So that's what was happening, right? But then Yisrael gets into the promised land. Okay, they get into the promised land as Yahuwah told them they would, but they rebelled. They wanted to have a physical earthly king like the other nations did. And Yahuwah said, I'll give them a king. You know, they're rejecting me. They're rejecting me. But you know what? I'm going to go ahead and give them a king. Okay, so he gives them a king, and then they start fighting over territory and all this other stupid stuff. So Israel splits into two kingdoms, the north and the south. And the north is called the house of Israel. All throughout the Tanakh, it's called the house of Israel, and the southern kingdom is called the house of Yehuda, or the house of Judah, which makes up Judah, Benjamin, and a few Levites, and then the northern kingdom makes up the other 10 tribes and a mixture of Levites. So you have this progressive story now. Now they're split up, you know, two kingdoms, and they're stiff-necked, they're rebellious, they're disobeying the commandments of Yahuwah, the law of Moses, all the commandments. And eventually the father divorces, he says in Jeremiah chapter 3, he divorces the house of Israel. He writes a certificate of divorce and allows them to get taken into captivity. And this is what starts to happen. They're taken and they're dispersed all over the world, just like he prophesied in the Torah. Okay? Without me getting into it too deep, I'm trying to keep it real short. That's part of the curse, is that they were going to be scattered and dispersed all over the world. And so right here, we get to this point where the Messiah is born on earth, okay, around 0 AD. Let's just give a time period, okay, around that time. So thousands of years have passed since Israel was developed as a nation, as a people. And since they got into the promised land, they were split up. The northern kingdom was scattered all over the place. And the only people right now that are in the promised land, that are in Yerushalayim, and that still have the temple somewhat, is the house of Judah, the house of Yehuda, the southern kingdom. And the Messiah was born out of that kingdom. He was born out of Yehuda. That's why it says he's a king of Yehuda, but then it also says he's a king of Yisrael. And right here he's saying, I have not come for the lost sheep of the house of Yisrael. The lost sheep of the house of Yisrael are those who have been scattered. Those of the northern kingdom who have been scattered and are living amongst Gentiles. They're living amongst other people. That's what it's about, man. This is powerful. Powerful. You want to talk about why did Messiah come to the earth? I was never taught this in Christianity. I was taught he came to the earth to die for the sins of man and to show his love. And that's true. Okay? I'm not neglecting that. Okay? The Christian church has pushed that message, which is a true message, but it's not the whole message. And if it's not the whole message, it's not the true message. So, let's keep going with the story here. I am not sent. I am not sent. This is not my purpose. This is not my destiny. But for the lost sheep of the house of Yisrael. Wow. That's powerful. Then she came and worshipped him, saying, Master, help me. But he answered and said, It is not meet. Okay? It is not proper to take the children's bread. What's the children's bread? Who are the children? The children are Yisrael. That's the children. It's always been the children. Look at the Old Testament. Look at the whole storyline. Those who are, well, since the time of Jacob, like I said, those who've been who are obedient to the Father's commandments and instructions. Okay? And from the time of Jacob forward, especially from the time of Moses forward, the chosen people is Israel. And that's his children. That's the children of the Father. Okay, whom he chastises and disciplines. That's his children. It's Israel. Nobody else. So it is not proper to take the children's bread. What is the bread of the children? It's the word of Yahuwah. It's his word. It's his instructions. It's his desire, his will, his commandments, his judgments, his statutes. The Messiah said when he was being tempted by Satan, he said, Man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of Elohim, of Yahuwah. So that's what the word is. Amen? Let's keep going. That's the children's bread, is the word. And in this context, what else? She's asking for healing, right? She's asking for deliverance. She's asking for help, and he's saying it's not proper to give the children's bread. So in this context, literally, the Messiah is talking about miracles, okay? And check out her answer. It was amazing. I love her answer. Oh, hold on. Let me finish that statement. He said, it is not meet to take the children's bread and cast it to dogs. Ouch. He just called that woman a dog. And she said, Truth, Master, this is true. And she said, Yet the dogs eat the crumbs which fall from their master's table. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, man. That is an awesome comeback. Awesome comeback. All right. Fix this camera a little bit. Sorry about this, guys. Okay. But even the dogs eat the crumbs which fall from their master's table. Then Yahusha answered and said to her, O woman, great is thy faith. Great is thy faith. Be it to thee even as thou wilt. Let it be done unto you as you wish. And her daughter was healed from that very hour. What can we learn from this? Some of you might be thinking that I'm saying that Gentiles can't be saved, but that's not true. You probably haven't been listening to me very closely because I just mentioned to you that all over the Old Testament, Gentiles were allowed to live amongst the Israelites and be considered an Israelite and have the same laws and same commandments. In other words, they were able to have the same bread. Okay? But what the Messiah was saying was, if you're not my child, if you're not a believer, if you're not faithful to me, you don't deserve my bread. Okay, but this woman obviously had what? Faith. She had faith. Okay? It doesn't mention anything here about her obeying the law of Moses and keeping the Ten Commandments and all that. Perfectly fine. Absolutely not. It doesn't say that. Simply, she came to the man who had the answers, who had the ability to cast out this demon from her daughter so that she can be healed, and he did it. Why? Because she had faith. And that is number one. Number one, all over the scriptures. All over the scriptures. From Genesis all the way to the end of the book, Revelation. It's number one, faith. I preach that. I believe that. I don't preach against that. Okay? However, let's read a passage of scripture. Matthew chapter 7, verses 21 to 23. And it reads like this. Is it 7? I believe it's 7, sorry. Matthew chapter 7, verses 21 to 23. Okay? Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, okay? Or Master, Master. Just like this woman said, Master, right? She said, Lord, please, I know who you are. I know you can heal my daughter. He says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. But he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. Doing the will and having a little bit of faith to start off your walk. Those are two distinct things. Doing the will is about action. Doing the will is about obedience. Doing the will is about, as James chapter 2 says, putting faith and works and combining them together to perfect your faith. In other words, having perfect faith. Doing the will is different. Starting to do the will is having faith. That's the beginning. But then the test comes in the progress, in the process of how you walk out the rest of your life from that point forward. So in other words, not everyone who says, Master, Master, or Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but those who do the will of my Father who is in heaven. Many will tell me in that day, Lord, Lord, did not we prophesy in your name? In your name cast out demons, and in your name do many mighty works. Many miracles. Many miracles. Now, a lot of people like to preach this and say it's hypothetical. It's not true. Like, miracles didn't happen. I just disagree. Like I said, this woman didn't need to be obedient. She didn't need to prove that she was obedient to any commandments. She simply believed and had faith that he was the one that can heal her. And based upon that, she got what she requested. What she does from the rest of her life, from that point forward, she has a voluntary free will choice to continue to follow him, to start to conform her life to the Messiah, or not. Okay? Verse 23. And then I will tell them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness or iniquity, which is transgressing the law, transgressing the Torah, transgressing the law of Moses. That's what sin is. So those who practice that, that's going to be their reward. Depart from me, you worker of iniquity. I never knew you. Despite the miracles, despite the signs and the wonders, which you'll hear a lot of testimony in Christianity about that. People being healed, you'll hear eyes being opened, you'll hear people raising, you know, being raised from the dead in third world countries. I mean, I've never seen it, but you hear about all this stuff. Leprosy being healed from people, people growing limbs back. That's all well and good. That's all peachy keen. I love it. Hallelujah. I praise Yahuwah. Hallelujah. A person's been healed. That's great. I've even had experience of casting out a demon out of a woman in the name of Jesus. I've done it as a social worker on the clock while I'm working. 40-something year old woman growling like an animal slouches down on the ground, starts to bleed out of her face while I'm casting out the devil from her. I believe it. It can happen. Why? Because of faith. I believe faith is very important. It's primary, it's number one. Now, I'm going to keep on going, but the point is here, guys. To whom much is given, much is required. What do you do after you have faith? What is your step? If truth is revealed to you, if a brother comes to me right now and shows to me, brother, you know, his name's not really Jesus. And they take, in love and in mercy and patience, they take their time to sit with me and to open up the scriptures and to open up a concordance and to do some research and show some history. They invest time into you. I owe it, not just to that person, but primarily I owe it to my maker, whom I told I commit myself to your word, your scriptures. I owe it to him to respect the time that this person is investing in me and the material that he's bringing forth for me to consider. Now, if I brush that off and say, oh, brother, his name's Jesus. That's just what his name is, brother. Is that faith? Or is that tradition? Is that faith? Or is it addiction? Is that faith? Or is it man-made religion? Very important. We are responsible for what we hear and what we're given. Verse 24 of Matthew 7 says, everyone, therefore, who hears these words of mine and does them will be compared to a wise man who built his house on a rock. The rain came down, the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, and it did not fall. For it was founded on the rock. Book of Matthew, folks. And everyone who hears these words of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. And the rain came down and the floods came and the winds blew and beat on that house and it fell and great was its fall. I mean, that's really clear. The Messiah is teaching us the difference between faith and works. Faith and obedience. He's showing it to us right here. And he's commanding and demanding us to be obedient and to demonstrate the fruit of our faith by works. All right, let's get back to the study here. So this woman got what she requested. She got, her daughter got delivered. She got healing. The demon got cast out of her. Hallelujah. You know, and that's primarily because of faith. Okay? But that does not neglect that now she has to conform herself to the Messiah and start obeying his commandments and learning from him. Or in that context, at least start to conforming to the scriptures that he followed, which was all of the Old Testament, law and the prophets. So she should devote her life now to going to the synagogue and the temple on the Sabbath and start learning about that Torah. Hallelujah. Okay, Matthew 15, verse 30 to 31. And great multitudes came to him, having with them those that were lame, blind, dumb, maimed, and many others, and cast them down at Yahushua's feet, and he healed them. Hallelujah. So that the multitude wondered when they saw the dumb to speak, the maimed to behold, the lame to walk, and the blind to see. They glorified the Elohim of Yisrael. It doesn't say they glorified the Elohim, the God of Christianity. It doesn't say they glorified the God of Christ. It says the Elohim of Israel, or the God of Israel, it would say in your scriptures, Christian. And if I didn't make that clear, Elohim is simply the Hebrew word for God, okay? Mighty One, okay? Most High, whatever. So there you go. Elohim of Israel, that's the purpose, what? To glorify, get people to glorify the Elohim of Israel. And I don't know if that's really the, deep down, that's the intention of Christianity. Their intention is to get people to glorify the God of Christianity. Their version of Christianity. Not the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And Moses. Okay, Matthew 19:27-29. Matthew 19:27-29. It says, "Then answered Peter," or Kepha, "and said to him, Behold, we have forsaken all and followed you. And what shall we have therefore?" And Yahushua said to them, "Verily I say to you that he who have followed me in the regeneration," I'm gonna say that again, "Verily I say to you that ye who have followed me in the regeneration, when the Son of Man shall sit on the throne of his glory, ye shall also shall sit upon 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel." This is a big deal. This is prophetic. This is what's going to happen in the future. Israel will be judged. They're going to be held accountable. "And everyone that has forsaken houses or brethren or sisters or father or mother or wife or children or lands for my name's sake shall receive a hundredfold and shall inherit everlasting life." And then I have a note here for 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 17. Let's see what that says. 1 Peter 4, 17. "For the time has come for judgment to begin with the household of Elohim. And if it first begins with us, what will happen to those who do not obey the good news of Elohim?" What is the household of Elohim, guys? That's my question to you. And I'm proposing to you by showing you all these scriptures that it is Israel. That is the household. That's the house. If you're not in the house, you're not in the house. It's just that simple. You're not in the house. You're outside. You got to be inside. And the only way inside is through the front door. You can't go through the window. You can't go through the roof. You can't go through the back door. Let's keep going. Got to be Israel. Matthew chapter 23, verse 37. "O Yerushalayim, Yerushalayim, thou that killest the prophets and stones them who are sent to thee, how often would I have gathered thy children, even as a hen gathers her chickens under her wings, and ye would not. Behold, your house is left to you desolate, for I say to you, ye shall not see me henceforth till ye shall say, Blessed is he who comes in the name of Yahuwah." Psalm 118, verse 26. That's not Lord. Lord is not his name. It's YHWH for Yahuwah. Blessed is he who comes in the name of Yahuwah. Okay. Matthew. So what's the point of this one? Again, it's saying, "O Yerushalayim, Yerushalayim, thou that killest the prophets and stones them who are sent to thee, how often would I have gathered thy children?" Okay. Again, this context, he's talking about Yisrael. Yerushalayim is, many times Yisrael is called after Yerushalayim because Yerushalayim was the capital. It was the most important place in Israel. It's where the temple was. So symbolically, this is talking about Israel and the children of Israel. Same theme. Okay. Matthew 27, verse 42. "He saved others. Himself he cannot save. If he is the king of Israel, as he claims to be, or as many claim that he is," right? "Let him now come down from the cross or from the tree or from the stake, and we will believe him. Even the worst sinner," this is my notes here, "even the worst sinner was aware that our Messiah proclaimed to be the King of Israel." My question to you, Christian, who's your king? And if you say that he is your king, the one that I'm reading about, what does that make you? A Christian or an Israelite? Got to ask these questions. All right, moving forward. Part two. How long have I been doing this video here? It doesn't tell me. All right. Hopefully it's not over an hour long. Mark 12, 28, verse 31. And one of the scribes came, and having heard them reasoning together and perceiving that he had answered them well, asked him, which is the first commandment of all? And Yahushua answered him, the first of all the commandments is, hear, O Yisrael, Yahuwah, our Elohim, is one Yahuwah. That's a quote from Deuteronomy 6:4. Wow. He opens up with, hear, O Israel. Hear, O Israel. Yahuwah is one. He never changes. He is one. He is the one. And then what follows is, and thou shalt love Yahuwah thy Elohim with all thy heart and with all thy soul and with all thy mind and with all thy strength. This is the first commandment. And the second is like it. Namely, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. There is no other greater. There is no commandment greater than these. Okay? Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 4 and 5. Hear, O Yisrael. It doesn't say, hear, O Christianity. Okay? It doesn't say that. Hear, O Yisrael, who are you? Who's your king and what does that make you? That's my question. Luke chapter 1, verse 46 to 55. Luke 1, 46 to 55. And Mary said, my soul does magnify Yahuwah, and my spirit has rejoiced in Elohim, my Savior, for he has regarded the low estate of his handmaiden. For behold, from thenceforth, all generations will call me blessed. For he that is mighty has done to me great things, and set apart is his name. Set apart is his name. Set apart is his name. It's not like any other. And his mercy is on them that fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts. He has put down the mighty from their seats and exalted them of low degree. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent away empty. He has sustained his servant Israel. He has sustained his servant Yisrael in remembrance of his mercy, as he spoke to our fathers, to Abraham, to his seed forever. I hope you're getting the picture. Israel is his chosen people. They are his chosen people. And you need to become Israel. You need to be grafted in. You need to join Israel today. So Christian, if you're listening to this video, pray right now. Pray, but keep listening to this video. Don't stop. I know this is hard and it hurts, but keep listening. I'm giving you straight scripture. Luke chapter 1, verse 76 to 80. And thou shalt, child, shall be called the prophet of the highest, for thou shalt go before the face of Yahusha to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation to his people by the remission of their sins, through the tender mercy of our Elohim, by which the day spring from on high has visited us, to give light to them that sit in darkness and in the shades of death, to guard our feet into the way of peace. And the child grew, okay? And the child grew, talking about Yohanan the Baptist, John the Baptist, the immerser, okay? And the child grew and became strong in spirit and was in the deserts till the day of his showing to Yisrael. He was prepping himself to come and present himself before Yisrael. Luke chapter 2, verse 25 to 32. And behold, there was a man in Yerushalayim whose name was Simeon, and the same man was just and devout, waiting for the consolation of Yisrael. He was waiting for the consolation of Yisrael. When all things come together, he's waiting for salvation. He's waiting for that king. He's hearing about this king coming. He's been longing for the king to come back so we can get away from this Roman Babylonian empire that's above our heads. Okay? This man was waiting for that. And the set-apart spirit was upon this man. And it was revealed to him by the set-apart spirit that he should not see death before he had seen Yahuwah's Messiah. And he came by the spirit into the temple. And when the parents brought in the child, Yahusha, to do for him after the custom of the law, then he took him up in his arms and blessed him and said, Yahuwah, now let thou thy servant depart in peace according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared before the face of all people, a light to enlighten the Gentiles, a light to enlighten the nations. The Gentiles, a light. That means the Gentiles are in darkness for the most part. They are in darkness, but he has come to be a light to the Gentiles and the glory of thy people, Yisrael. This is powerful. The purpose is for Yisrael to be a light. Yisrael, light. His real light. That's what Israel's purpose was supposed to be on the earth. For all time, it was always to be salt and light on the earth. It's not a new concept. Their goal was to be set apart, to be distinct, to show the other nations that the Mighty One, the Elohim that they serve, is the best. He's the only one. But they failed. Only a remnant succeeded, but the majority of them failed. And it cost them a lot of trouble and a lot of consequences. But what is the purpose right here? Oh my goodness. Luke chapter 2, verse 32 says, a light to enlighten the Gentiles. That's what the purpose of the Messiah was to be. He was to be a light to enlighten the Gentiles and the glory of his people, Israel. That's powerful. The goal is to get those nations, those Gentiles, and to bring them into this light, into this glory. Hallelujah. You got to come into this glory. If you don't come into this glory, the glory that you're singing about in church ain't going to get you into the kingdom, bro. It's not going to get you there. This message you're listening to is very dangerous because now you're going to be held accountable. Luke chapter 2, verse 33 to verse 35. And Joseph and his mother marveled at those things which were spoken concerning him. And Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother, behold, this child is set for the fall and the rising again of many in Israel. The fall and the rise of many in Israel. He didn't say everyone. He said many, meaning a remnant. Because there's many who fell, but there's a bounce back. They're going to make a bounce back. They're going to come back. Okay? People are going to come into the truth. People are going to start obeying. People are going to come back into covenant. People are going to be faithful. Are you going to be on that boat? Are you going to be on that boat? Are you going to ride that wave with us? Are you going to stay on your little canoe? So this is for the rising again of many in Israel and for a sign which shall be spoken against. And a sword shall pierce through thy own soul also, that the thoughts of many hearts may be revealed. I see a lot of people's hearts get revealed when I start preaching faith and the law of Moses. Their hearts really start to get manifest. I see so, there's no in-between. I haven't really seen much of an in-between. I've seen either you love the word, or you hate the word. There's no in between. You either love the law of Moses or you don't. There is no in between, man. You either love it or you don't. And I've seen it. I've been involved in many debates, many unfruitful debates, debates that I should have pulled out of a long time ago, but I kept going. And now I'm learning to pull out early, because there's some people who are just hard-hearted, stiff-necked. They're not ready, you know, but they should still hear the truth anyway, right? So that's sometimes why I keep preaching, because they're still accountable. It doesn't matter. All I'm doing is preaching the word. Who is the one that's got to open their hearts and open their minds and open their eyes? So sometimes I keep preaching because I have that motivation. There's a chance. There's an opportunity. But sometimes, if I'm discerning, I'm feeling the spirits like, nah, D, pull out. Just let it go. Let it go. You said enough. You've said enough. You've given enough for him to be accountable. So, but it says here that the hearts of many will be revealed. Luke chapter 24, verse 18 to 21. And one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answering, said to him, art thou only a stranger in Jerusalem, and hast not known the things which have come to pass there in these days? Okay, I believe they're talking to the Messiah here, because he's walking amongst these guys, but he's not allowing them to see who he is. Either he's closed their eyes to see who the Messiah is, or the Messiah has transformed himself in an image that they don't recognize. Either way, they don't recognize it's him, and they're like, have you not heard about what's been going on? And he said to them, what things? And they said to him, concerning Yahusha of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before Elohim and all the people, and how the chief priests and our rulers delivered him to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we trust that it had been he who would have redeemed Yisrael. These people, these Jews, these Yahudim, are longing for the redemption of Yisrael. There's no such thing as the redemption of a kingdom of Christianity. There's no such thing. It doesn't exist in all of Scripture. And the only two verses that you see with the word Christian in it is not a defense for it. It is very weak. It is very weak. And there's a lot of history behind why the word Christian is in there rather than a messianic or a Nazarene. There's a lot of history there. Okay? I can get into that in another video. But these guys are waiting for the redemption of Yisrael. And besides all this, today is the third day since these things were done. Moving on. Luke, must have missed this one. Luke chapter 1, verse 46 to 55. Let me go back up, make sure I'm not repeating myself. Luke 1. Nope, I did that one already. Let's move forward. Luke 76, 80, I did that one. Oh, I got all Luke. I got Luke in here twice. All right, John. The book of John, chapter 1, verse 25 to 39. And they asked him and said to him, why do you immerse thou then, if you are not the Messiah, nor Elijah, neither that prophet? And Yohanan, John, answered them, saying, I immerse with water, but there stands one among you whom ye know not. He it is who is coming after me, who is preferred before me, whose shoes latchet I am not worthy to unloose. These things were done in Bethabara, beyond Jordan, where John was immersing. The next day, John seeth Yahusha. He saw Yahusha coming to him and said, behold, the Lamb of Elohim, who takes away the sin of the world. Hallelujah. This is he of whom I said, after me comes a man who is preferred before me, for he was before me, and I knew him not. But that he should be made manifest to Yisrael. That's his purpose, to be manifest to Yisrael. He said, I have not come for the lost sheep of Yisrael. He came to be the king, the shepherd of Yisrael, the governor, the ruler of Yisrael. He came to manifest himself to Yisrael. He came to be the glory of Yisrael and a light to the Gentiles. This is strong evidence that the chosen people are Yisrael. And John bore testimony. I'm sorry, it says, and may manifest, his purpose is to be made manifest to Yisrael. Therefore, I came immersing with water. And John bore testimony saying, I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it abode upon him. And I knew him not, but he that sent me to immerse with water, the same said to me, upon whom you shall see the Spirit descending and remaining on him, the same is he who is immersing with the set-apart Spirit. And I saw and bore testimony that this is the Son of Elohim. Again, the next day, after John stood, two of his disciples, and looking upon Yahusha as he walked, he said, Behold the Lamb of Elohim. And the two disciples heard him speak, and they followed Yahusha. Then Yahusha turned and saw them following and said to them, What are you seeking? They said to him, Rabbi, which is to be interpreted, Master or Teacher. Where do you dwell? Where are you dwelling? He said to them, Come and see. They came and saw where he dwelt and abode with him that day, for it was about the 10th hour. John chapter 12, verse 12 to 13. John 12, 12 to 13. On the next day, many people that had come to the feast, when they heard that Yahusha was coming to Yerushalayim, took branches of palm trees and went forth to meet him and cried, Hosanna! Hosanna! Blessed is the King of Yisrael that cometh in the name of Yahuwah. Blessed is the King of Yisrael. It doesn't say blessed is the King of Christianity. It doesn't say blessed is the King of Christians. Just doesn't say it. Again, you only see the word Christian twice in the New Testament, and it's nowhere in the gospel letters. Yisrael is the main focus. Okay, guys, I think I've definitely been on here for an hour, probably more. I'm going to keep on going. I got the book of Acts now, okay? Book of Acts. And being assembled together with them, he commanded them not to depart from Yerushalayim, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, You have heard from me. For John truly baptized or truly immersed with water, but you shall be immersed with the set-apart Spirit, the Ruach HaKodesh, not many days from now. Therefore, when they had come together, they asked him, saying, Master, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Yisrael? Whew. That message has never changed. But Christianity is trying to preach a different message. Christianity builds their own kingdom, which is not the kingdom of the Messiah that we're reading about right now. It's a different kingdom. It is not the kingdom that the Creator wanted to build since the time of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Moses. It's a different kingdom. They were trying to build the kingdom of Yisrael. Yisrael, a chosen, set-apart people, a remnant. Christianity is not preaching that kingdom message. But right here, guys, Acts chapter 1, Master, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Yisrael? He said to them, It is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father has put in his own authority. That means what they're asking for is going to happen, is just not the right time for you to know when it's going to happen. He didn't say what... It's no longer the kingdom to Israel. It's the kingdom to the Gentiles now. He never said that. He never said it's the kingdom now of Christianity. Never said that. Never, ever, ever. And he said to them, it is not for you to know the times, seasons which your Father has put in his own authority, but you shall receive power when the Ruach HaKodesh, the set-apart spirit, has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Yerushalayim and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. Are we being witnesses to the true Messiah? Are we being witnesses to the true Messiah who said in Matthew chapter 23, verse 1 to 3, that we are to obey all of the law of Moses? All those who sit in the seat of Moses and who teach the seat of Moses, or who teach the law of Moses, we are to obey all that they command us. And then in Matthew 28, he commands his disciples to go and make disciples of all nations, teaching them to obey and observe all things that the Messiah commanded. That includes Matthew chapter 23, verse 1 to 3. Are we being witnesses? Christian, are you being a true witness of the true Messiah? Or are you being a witness to a lawless, Torahless Messiah? Are you preaching a Torahless gospel? Are you preaching a Torahless message, a lawless message? Or is it a law-establishing message? Does it put the law in its proper place? Faith first, then obedience. It's a very important question. I lost my place. Okay. I think I said restore the kingdom to Israel already. It is not for time. Yep, Acts 2:22. Men of Israel, hear these words. Oof, I lost my place. Getting excited. Acts 2:22-36. Men of Israel, Acts chapter 2:22-36. Men of Israel, hear these words. Yahusha of Nazareth, a man attested by Elohim to you by miracles, wonders, and signs which Elohim did through him. I know where I was now. Witnesses. Yep. I was witnesses. I was in Acts chapter 1 and witnesses, the last part of verse 8. So it says, you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem, in all Judea, Samaria, and to the end of the earth. I actually finished that. Sorry. So that's the point, to make disciples of all nations, right? To go all over the world, to Gentiles and Jews and Yisraelites alike. Everybody has to get the same message. Everybody has to go through the same door. Doesn't matter if you were born an Israelite or not, okay? Doesn't matter if you're black or white. Okay. I don't like Michael Jackson at all. Sorry, guys.
Bringing in that pagan
song. Yeah, don't bring, my wife said, don't bring that pagan song up in this house. I do not like Michael Jackson at all. Okay. Acts chapter 2, verse 22-36. Men of Israel, hear these words. Yahusha of Nazareth, a man attested by Elohim to you by miracles, wonders, and signs which Elohim did through him in your midst, as you yourselves also know, him being delivered by the determined purpose and foreknowledge of Elohim, you have taken by lawless hands. I'm going to read that again. Him being delivered by the determined purpose and foreknowledge of Elohim, it was intended and already foreknown that this would happen, predestined, you have taken by lawless hands, have crucified and put to death, whom Elohim raised up, having loosed the pains of death, because it was not possible that he should be held by it. For David says concerning him, I foresaw, that's foreknowledge, I've seen in the future, a prophecy, seen a vision. I foresaw Yahuwah always before my face, for he is at my right hand, that I may not be shaken. Therefore my heart rejoiced, and my tongue was glad. Moreover, my flesh also will rest in hope. For you will not leave my soul in Hades, okay, in the pits, in the dark pits, in Sheol. For nor will you allow your set-apart one, the Messiah, to see corruption. You have made known to me the ways of life. You will make me full of joy in your presence. Men and brethren, Let me speak freely to you of the patriarch David, that he is both dead and buried, and his tomb is with us to this day. Therefore, being a prophet and knowing that Elohim had sworn with an oath to him that of the fruit of his body according to the flesh he would raise up the Messiah to sit on his throne, he, foreseeing this, spoke concerning the resurrection of the Messiah that his soul was not left in Sheol or in Hades, nor did his flesh see corruption. This Yahusha Elohim has raised up, of which we are all witnesses. So this Yahusha Elohim has raised up, of which we are all witnesses. Therefore, being exalted to the right hand of Elohim, and having received from the Father the promise of the Ruach HaKodesh, he poured out this which you now see and hear. For David did not ascend into the heavens, but he says himself, Yahuwah said to my master, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool. Therefore, here's the key verse I want to focus on. Therefore, let all the house of Yisrael know assuredly that Elohim has made this Yahusha, whom you crucified, both master and Messiah. That's very key, guys. Let all the house of Israel know this. Are you letting all the house of Israel know this? I'm letting all the house of Israel know this. That's why I'm using my Facebook and my YouTube channel to do. I'm using my music to do that. I'm using my studies. I'm putting it up on social media. And I want you, my Israelite brothers and sisters, to do the same thing. Let's flood YouTube before we can't even use it no more. Let's get out there. Let's get out on the streets. Let's preach. Let's go to some churches. Let's interrupt some services. Let's try to meet with some pastors. Let's try to meet with Christians. When I'm in the public, I've been starting conversations with Christians like this. And it's been, man, I wish I could record it. True or false? I just want to ask you guys a question. You guys believe in the Bible, right? They say, yeah, of course. We just came from church. It's Sunday, right? Y'all believe in the Bible, right? Okay, I just want to ask you guys one question, and it can lead into some conversation. We don't have to spend too much time on it. You know, whatever you guys have. I just got one true or false question. Did Jesus die on the cross so that we don't have to obey the law of Moses anymore? Or another way you can rephrase it is, did Jesus die to abolish the law? I mean, that one's a real, that's setting them up for a trap, because obviously Messiah says the exact opposite in Matthew chapter 5, verse 17. But anyway, I start the conversation like that and it opens up, man. I mean, I've had a good time. We were at Tropical Pollo. I don't know if it was last Sunday or the Sunday before that, but it was a good conversation we had. And I threw out all those, you know, a lot of scriptures, really three main scriptures, Matthew chapter 28, the Great Commission, Matthew 23, 1-3, and then Matthew 5, 17, 18, and 19. And I gave them a lot to think about, you know. So anyway, but that's what we're called to do, man. We got to preach this word. We got to preach this word. Acts chapter 5, verse 17-31. Then the high priest rose up and all those who were with him, which is the sect of the Sadducees, and they were filled with indignation and laid their hands on the apostles and put them in the common prison. But at night, an angel of Yahuwah opened the prison doors and brought them out and said, go stand in the temple and speak to the people all the words of this life. And when they heard that they entered the temple early in the morning and taught, the high priest and those with him came and called the council together with all the elders of the children of Israel and sent to the prison to have them brought. But when the officers came and did not find them in the prison, they returned and reported, saying, indeed, we found the prison shut securely and the guards standing outside before the doors. But when we opened them, we found no one inside. Now, when the high priest, the captain of the temple, and the chief priests heard these things, they wondered what the outcome would be. So one came and told them, saying, look, the men whom you put in prison are standing in the temple and teaching the people. The captain went with the officers and brought them without violence, for they feared the people lest they should be stoned. And when they had brought them, they set them before the council. And the high priest asked them, saying, did we not strictly command you not to teach in this name? It almost sounds like Christianity today, that don't let us preach Yahusha. Even some messianic synagogues, man. I've heard a testimony of a sister who said she actually got it's almost like a restraining order. It's forgot the word for it. I think it starts with a T. But she was basically kicked out of a messianic synagogue. People who believe in the Messiah and who are supposed to be observing the Torah, the law of Moses, but they believe in the name Yeshua is the name of the Messiah. Yeshua. Rather than Yahusha, which there's a difference, guys. And if you want to know the difference, watch one of my videos on YouTube titled Yahusha, Yahushua, Yeshua, Jesus to Jesus, the progressive destruction of the Messiah's name. That's the title of the message. It's pretty long, but so this woman got kicked out of this messianic synagogue for just saying the name Yahusha. You know, she's loving everybody else. She's loving, you know, the congregation. She participates. She was a member there. She was attending. All she's doing is just whenever they're worshiping and singing, she's just saying Yahusha. And this guy kicked her out and legally had police come and take her out and then had her prohibited from going to that building again. It's crazy, man. Let alone in Christianity, if you try to use the name Yahusha in a Christian church, oh my goodness. All hell will break loose. You'll see a lot of demons manifest. But this is what's happening, man. These Jews don't want these people preaching in the name of Yahusha. Did we not strictly command you not to teach in this name? And look, you have filled Yerushalayim with your doctrine and intend to bring this man's blood on us. But Peter and the other apostles answered and said, We ought to obey Elohim rather than men. The Elohim of our fathers raised up Yahusha, whom you murdered by hanging on a tree. Him, Elohim, has exalted to his right hand to be prince and savior, to give repentance to Yisrael and forgiveness of sins. That's the verse I was trying to go to. Him, Elohim, the Father, has exalted to his right hand to be prince and savior, to give repentance to Yisrael. That was the purpose of the Messiah, to come and to allow Yisrael to be restored in relationship. I'm not talking about physical restoration, because that's yet to come. The physical restoration to be restored into the promised land, into the kingdom on earth that is supposed to happen prophetically, as spoken of in Ezekiel and Isaiah and all the other passages, prophetic passages of scripture, that is yet to come. But the Messiah restored the relationship, the covenant. Yeah, he could have came and did it all in one shot. But think about this. This is for all my non-messianic Yisraelite people who have abandoned the messianic faith. If the Messiah would have waited all the way to the future when he's going to physically restore the kingdom and the relationship of Yisrael, where in the world do you think that's going to put you and me? If we die right now, we would have no hope. You don't know who you are. You're trying to follow the Torah. You're trying to follow the Torah and all this stuff. But you lack to understand that in Jeremiah chapter 3, he actually wrote a certificate of divorce to the house of Yisrael. And the temple was again destroyed in 70 AD. There's a lot of significance there. That old covenant, you're under the old covenant, which doesn't work anymore. It doesn't work. Jeremiah chapter 31, verse 31 to 33, is talking about a new covenant. It's about relationship. It's about relationship first. You guys get caught up. You get so caught up on the physical. You get so caught up on the physical. He hasn't come and restored us. We're all still in exile. We're all still scattered and we're still being oppressed. Yes, I understand. I understand. But he had to come first to restore the door, the gate to relationship so that many, 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 many nations can come in so that the fullness of the nations can be fulfilled. That was the reason, man. And he did it. He came. It's historically proven. This guy is real. He came. Yes, there's a lot of mixed information anyways. The hardest people to talk to, I think, are people who have tasted and seen the goodness of this message and have abandoned it. Just like it is for a Christian who has seen miracles, has seen demons cast out, who's been very active in ministry, who's fed the poor, just really involved in Christianity. And for them to fall and to say, you know what, I don't believe it anymore. I want to be an atheist or I want to be agnostic. It is 100 times harder for those people to come back because they've seen so much. And it's the same thing for these Israelites who believed in Torah and the Messiah, and now they've abandoned the whole New Testament altogether, and they only believe in the Old Testament. I'll tell you what, that ain't me. A lot of people say, oh, brother, you're heading down the path. You obey the law, and now you're starting to question Paul. Next thing you know, you're going to question the Messiah, and then you're going to exit out the whole New Testament. Nah, get behind me, Satan. I'm an open-minded man. I like to see truth. I like to call a spade a spade. If you can point to me that something in the scripture has been tampered with, I'm a man. And more than that, I'm a man of Yahuwah. I'm a man of truth, so I can swallow that. Okay, there's an error there. Oh, there's another one out of the 100 other ones that I've seen. And that's what happens when you copy the scriptures, copy after copy after copy after copy after copy. I mean, some things tend to get mistranslated, okay? But the main message is the same. The main prophetic message of the good news of a restoration of relationship and a new covenant, it's the same. And it matches very well with the New Testament. It's beautiful. And I don't have a reason to deny it. Why would I want to deny it? Anyway, that's another video right there. Oh, Acts chapter 7, verse 23 to 53. Woo, this is long. Acts chapter 7, verse 23 to 53. Now, when he was 40 years old, it came into his heart to visit his brethren, the children of Israel. That's who the brethren are. And seeing one of them suffer wrong, he defended and avenged him who was oppressed and struck down the Egyptian, talking about Moses. For he supposed that his brethren would have understood that Elohim would deliver them by his hand, but they did not understand. And the next day he appeared to two of them as they were fighting and tried to reconcile them, saying, men, you are brethren. Why do you wrong one another? But he who did his neighbor wrong pushed him away. He pushed Moses, saying, who made you ruler and judge over us? Do you want to kill me as you did that Egyptian yesterday? Then at this saying, Moses fled and became a dweller in the land of Midian, where he had two sons. And when 40 years had passed, an angel of Yahuwah appeared to him in a flame of fire in a bush in the wilderness of Mount Sinai. When Moses saw it, he marveled at the sight, and as he drew near to observe the voice of Yahuwah, and as he drew near to observe, the voice of Yahuwah came to him, saying, I am the Elohim of your fathers, the Elohim of Abraham, the Elohim of Yitzhak, and the Elohim of Jacob. And Moses trembled and dared not look. Then Yahuwah said to him, take your sandals off your feet, for the place where you stand is set apart ground. I have surely seen the oppression of my people who are in Egypt. I have heard their groaning and have come down to deliver them. And now come, I will send you to Egypt. This Moses, whom they rejected, saying, who made you ruler and judge? Is the one Elohim sent to be a ruler and a deliverer by the hand of the messenger or the angel who appeared to him in the bush. He brought them out after he had shown wonders and signs in the land of Egypt and in the Red Sea and in the wilderness 40 years. This is that Moses who said to the children of Israel. You see, even here, the prophet, the apostle here, and if I'm not mistaken, this is Stephen talking right before he gets stoned to death, if I'm not mistaken. Even here, they're bringing the whole Old Testament story and lining it up with the gospel message for today. This is relevant. You cannot preach the gospel without the Old Testament. You can't. It doesn't make any sense. It doesn't make any sense. This Moses, whom they rejected, saying, "Who made you ruler over us?" He brought them out after he had shown wonders and signs in the land of Egypt and in the Red Sea and in the wilderness 40 years. This is that Moses who said to the children of Israel, "Yahuwah, your Elohim, will raise up for you a prophet like me from your brethren. Him you shall hear." Moses is prophesying and saying that in the future, there's going to be a prophet like me from among you, from among the Israelites, whom you shall hear. This is he who was in the congregation in the wilderness with the angel who spoke to him on Mount Sinai. This is he who was in the congregation in the wilderness with the angel who spoke to him on Mount Sinai and with our fathers, the one who received the living oracles to give to us, whom our fathers would not obey, but rejected. And in their hearts they turned back to Egypt, saying to Aharon, "Make us gods, make us little Elohim to go before us. As for this Moses, whom brought us out of the land of Egypt, we do not know what has become of him." And they had made a calf or a bull in those days, offered sacrifices to the idol, and rejoiced in the works of their hands. Then Elohim turned and gave them up to worship the host of heaven, as it is written in the book of the prophets. "Did you offer me slaughter, animals, and sacrifices during 40 years in the wilderness, O house of Israel? You also took up the tabernacle of Moloch and the star of your God, your Elohim, Raphan, images which you made to worship, and I will carry you away beyond Babylon." It's a consequence. "Our fathers had the tabernacle of the witness in the wilderness, as he appointed instructing Moses to make it according to the pattern that he had seen." So there's a pattern that he saw that he was making. It was a blueprint. He saw a blueprint. He saw a legit image, and he was making an image, a shadow of the actual true substance. "To make it according to the pattern that he had seen, which our fathers, having received in turn, also brought with Yahusha into the land possessed by the Gentiles, whom Elohim drove out before the face of our fathers unto the days of David." And that Yahusha is obviously Yahusha, son of Nun. Okay, Joshua, you would know. You would call him Joshua. "Who found favor before Elohim and asked to find a dwelling for the Elohim of Jacob." Of Jacob. "But Solomon built him a house. However, the Most High does not dwell in temples made with hands, as the prophet says, 'Heaven is my throne and the earth is my footstool. What house will you build for me?' says Yahuwah. 'Or what is the place of my rest? Has my hand not made all these things? You stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears, you always resist the Ruach HaKodesh. You always resist the set-apart spirit of Yahuwah. As your fathers did, so do you. Which of the prophets did your fathers not persecute? And they killed those who foretold the coming of the Just One, of whom you now have become the betrayers and murderers, who have received the law by the direction of angels and have not kept it." This is clear, guys. The message, the whole message from the beginning all the way till the New Testament is consistent. The message is for Yisrael. Salvation is for Yisrael. The restoration is for Yisrael. The chosen people are Yisrael. The bride is Yisrael. The remnant is Yisrael. The kingdom is Yisrael. It's consistent. It's in harmony. This is context. I know there's some more passages in the books after Acts, so I'm gonna go there real quick, see what we can find. I know right off the top of my head, Ephesians is filled with it. Romans chapter 11, we're definitely gonna read that right now. I could be here all night. I'm gonna break this video up. I'm gonna have to chop up this video when I'm done with it. Part one, part two, part three, but I just wanna get it all out now. Okay. Look at this, Romans chapter 9. Let's look at this passage real quick. All right, let's back it up a little bit. Let's start from 9 and verse 1. Romans chapter 9, 10, and 11 all go together, by the way. You got to read it all together. So Romans chapter 9, verse 1. I tell you the truth in Messiah. I am not lying. My conscience testifying with me in the set apart spirit, that I have great sorrow and unceasing pain in my heart. For I could wish that I myself were accursed from Messiah for my brother's sake, my relatives according to the flesh, who are Israelites. Paul is saying, I wish that I could be cursed. Like, let me take the wrath. Just pour all your wrath on me for them, please. Who are Israelites, according to the flesh, whose is the adoption, the glory, the covenants, the giving of the law, the service, and the promises, of whom are the fathers, and from whom is Messiah as concerning the flesh, who is over all, Elohim, blessed forever. Amen. Don't get confused with all that extra words after that. Don't skip verse 4. Verse 4 is essential. To the Israelites was given the adoption. They're the ones that possess the message, the good news of salvation for the Gentiles. Remember we read in the book of Matthew that the Messiah came to be a light to the Gentiles and a glory to Israel? That's it. Boom. Whose is the adoption? Israel's responsible for this message of adoption. The glory, the covenants, it belongs to Israel. All of them, all the covenants, the giving of the law, the service and the promises. Oh man, this is great. But it is not, verse 6, but it is not as though the word of Elohim has come to nothing. Okay? His words didn't change. His words aren't, his words that he spoke, that the Father spoke, all the promises, okay? All the covenants, the law, the commandments, the instructions, the blessings and the curses, the consequences and the privileges and the rewards, they didn't come to nothing. They're not done away with. They didn't die and get nailed on a tree. For they are not all Israel that are of Israel. Not everybody who claims to be an Israelite is a true Israelite. Not everybody is shining their light. A lot of people's light is really dark. It's not lighting. It's not shining. Don't work. No oil in their lamps. No spirit. And I'm not talking about fake tongues neither. That's not true spirit. You want to know what the true spirit is? Romans chapter 8. I'm going to go there real quick. Because it's the chapter right before the one I'm reading right now. Read the whole chapter of Romans, but please don't skip over these few verses I'm about to read. Verse 5, for those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For the mind of the flesh is death, but the mind of the Spirit is life and peace. Because the mind of the flesh is hostile towards Elohim, for it is not subject to Elohim's law, Torah. Neither indeed can it be. It's impossible for a carnal, fleshly mind to submit to the law of the Creator. Those who are in the flesh can't please Elohim. But you are not in the flesh, but in the spirit, if it is so that the spirit of Elohim dwells in you. But if any man doesn't have the spirit of the Messiah, he is none of his. Guys, being in the flesh is not, being in the spirit is not speaking in tongues. Being in the spirit is not doing miracles. Being in the spirit is the ability to have some self-control and to conform your filthy, sinful lifestyle to the word of the Most High, to his law. To be in the spirit is to be willing to trash and smash down all of your idols, all of your celebrities, all of the things that you worship and put before the Creator and his word, whether it's your job, whether it's money, whether it's your family, whether it's friends and your social life. You got to put that thing, you got to put that stuff down and put the Messiah first. And some of that stuff that's on that list don't even need to be on that list. It don't need to be second. It don't need to be third. It don't need to be fourth or fifth. It needs to be off of that list. So that's what it is to be in the spirit. Not all Israel is Israel. Some Israelites are fake. Verse 7, neither because they are Abraham's offspring are they all children. So just because they're physical Israelites, physical offspring of Abraham, doesn't mean that they are all children. But your offspring will be accounted as from Isaac. That is, it is not the children of the flesh who are children of Elohim, but the children of the promise are counted as heirs. For this is a word of promise. At the appointed time, I will come, and Sarah will have a son. Not only so, but Rebekah also conceived by one, by our father Isaac, for being not yet born, neither having done anything good or bad, that the purpose of Elohim according to election, we're talking about election here, and we've been talking about the Israelites so far. That the purpose of Elohim according to election, we've been talking about the remnant, right? Not everyone who's Israel is of Israel, because we're talking about a remnant of Israel. So that the purpose of Elohim according to election might stand, not of works, but of him who calls. It was said to her, the elder will serve the younger, even as it is written, Jacob I love, but Esau I hated. What shall we say then? Is there unrighteousness with Elohim? May it never be. For he said to Moses, I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion. So then it is not of him who wills, nor of him who runs, but of Elohim who has mercy and chooses. For the scripture says to Pharaoh, for this very purpose I caused you to be raised up, that I might show you in you my power, and that my name might be proclaimed in all the earth, so that he has mercy on whom he desires, and he hardens whom he desires. A lot of Calvinists love to destroy Romans chapter 9 and claim that this is talking about Calvinists, that this is talking about those who have been predestined, the Christians who have been predestined to be saved. That's a bunch of baloney. And you can obviously see it because I'm starting from verse 1. You got to read the whole chapter. You got to understand what the context is. We're talking about Israel here. We're not talking about Christians. So they're a bunch of liars. They're deceivers. They're wolves in sheep's clothing. And I've debated Calvinists to their faces. I've debated 6 Calvinists in Taco Bell back in 2012. Okay? We were debating Trinity. We were debating Trinity. That was the first thing we started debating. And these were guys who I used to preach with. And I love these Calvinists. I love the fact that these Calvinists preach in the streets. That's cool. Not a lot of Christians are doing it, but the Reformed Baptist and the Calvinists, they get out there on the streets, man, and they preach, and I respect that. And they preach against a lot of sin, and I love that. You know, Paul Washer and all those guys, a lot of good stuff. But that whole tulip crap that they preach, the whole election for Christians and the Calvinists, that was from John Calvin, a man who created this doctrine. That's who they're following. They call themselves Calvinists. It's crazy, man. This is Romans chapter 9 in context. Whew, so fired up. If you're a Calvinist and you're seeing this message, you want to debate me, devotedtoyah@gmail.com. Email me. Let's set it up. Let's record it live. Let's go on YouTube so the whole world can see it. Oh my goodness. So Yahuwah, He hardens who he wants to harden. He does that. That's what he does. Just like when I'm preaching to some Christians, I try to teach them the law and try to show them that the law is not done away with. And their hearts are just so hard. They're so in the flesh. They don't want to receive this word. And that's because I believe Yahuwah has allowed them to be in that place. Either he has hardened their hearts or he allowed them to harden their own hearts. Regardless. Verse 19 of Romans 9. You will say then to me, why does he still find fault? For who can withstand his will? But indeed, O man, who are you to reply against Elohim? Will the thing formed ask of him who formed it, why do you make me like this? I mean, he's the potter, we're the clay. There it is in the next verse. Or hasn't the potter the right over the clay from the same lump to make one part a vessel of honor and one another for dishonor? He can do that. I believe in free will, but I also believe that Yahuwah's sovereignty can override our free will anytime he wants. And anyone who doesn't believe that just is picking and choosing what verses they want to choose to believe from the scriptures. The Calvinists believe that we don't have free will at all. And then you have a group called Arminians. Arminians believe that we have free will all the time and Yahuwah can never override our free will. That's ridiculous as well. They're both wrong. Both sides are wrong. It's like Republican and Democrat. They're both idiots. They're wrong. You have to bring those truths from each side and you got to bring it together. My wife's laughing. It's true. There is free will, but Yahuwah can override that free will anytime he wants for his purposes. And who are we to say to him, why'd you do that? Deep down inside, if you really think about it, because we've all sinned at some point in our lives, none of us deserve salvation. None of us. None of us. So he can choose anybody he wants at any time, and he can be 100% justified in it because we're filthy. Verse 22, what if Elohim, willing to show his wrath and to make his power known, endured with much patience vessels of wrath prepared for destruction? He was very patient with the Israelites, don't you think? I mean, have you read the Old Testament? Have you seen we're almost about 2,000, maybe 4,000 years of patience dealing with these stubborn Israelites? We're only living about 2,000 or so years after the Messiah was born on the earth. Less than 2,000 years after he started his ministry. So he spent more time showing mercy to Israel than he has shown to us right now. He's merciful. But his purpose is to show his wrath, to make his power known. And that he might make known the riches of his glory on vessels of mercy, which he prepared beforehand for glory. Us, whom he also called, not from the Jews only, but also from the Gentiles. We're going to get into that. What's happening with the Gentiles and the Jews? I'm going to tell you right now, in case you don't have time, you're going to turn off this video. And I made this public right now on Facebook, so hopefully other people are seeing this besides Israelites. But what I'm going to tell you right now is that Gentiles and Jews need to become Israel. Okay, read Ezekiel chapter 37. Read about the prophecy of the dry bones. Read about the prophecy of two sticks coming together. The house of Israel and the house of Judah coming together as one stick. That's the goal. They need to become one. They need to become Yisrael. And we're going to see that in Romans 11. Verse 25, as he says also in Hosea, I will call them my people, which were not my people. Oh boy. And her beloved, who was not beloved. That's from Hosea chapter 2, verse 23. That's a prophecy. You can't preach the gospel in proper context without using the law and the prophets. I will call them my people, which were not my people. He's talking about Gentiles. And he's talking about the Israelites that got scattered and dispersed As a consequence, Jeremiah chapter 3, the divorce, the certificate of divorce, the house of Israel that disobeyed and rejected his commandments and that started to live all over the world, started living amongst the Gentiles. You see, when you're a Gentile and you live amongst Israelites, you are to become as an Israelite. That's what the book of Leviticus says, and Deuteronomy and Numbers. All the books of the Torah, they say you're to treat a Gentile like a native born. They are to be treated as one who was born in the land. And it's the same vice versa. If you are an Israelite and you start living amongst Gentiles and you start adopting yourselves to their ways and their customs, you become a Gentile. I don't care if you're physically an Israelite or not. You're not, like we just read right here. Not all who say they're Israel are of Israel. Not everyone who is of Abraham's seed is a child. If you're sinful and nasty and stank, nasty and disgusting, you are not a child. You're a pig and you're a dog. Just like the Gentiles are. That's what they are. They eat their pig. They like to eat their rat and mice and snakes and all that nasty stuff. All that fake stuff, okay, all that nasty abominable foods, okay, they have no stance on homosexuality, okay, they keep all these pagan holidays, they don't like to embrace the feast days of the Most High. So, this is prophetic. Hosea chapter 2, verse 23 is talking about two groups of people. It's talking about Gentiles, as in people who were never Israelites ever, and it's also talking about those who used to be Israelites and got scattered and dispersed. He's saying, I will call them my people who were not my people, and her beloved who was not beloved. Verse 26, it will be that in the place where it was said to them, you are not my people, there they will be called the children of the living Elohim. Hosea chapter 1, verse 10. You got to read Hosea chapter 1 and 2. You got to read both chapters together. Isaiah cries concerning Yisrael. Paul is bringing us back to the subject here, letting us know, making sure you're not losing track. We're not talking about Calvinists. We're not talking about Reformed Baptists. We're not talking about Christianity. We are talking about Israel. Verse 27, Isaiah cries concerning Israel. If the number of the children of Israel are as the sand of the sea, it is the remnant who will be saved. For he will finish the work and cut it short in righteousness, because Yahuwah will make a short work upon the earth. Isaiah chapter 10, verses 22 to 23. That's a quote. Verse 29, as Isaiah has said before, unless Yahuwah of armies had left us a seed, we would have become like Sodom and would have become like Gomorrah. Isaiah chapter 1, verse 9. Verse 30, what shall we say then? That the Gentiles who didn't follow after righteousness attained righteousness, even the righteousness which is of faith. But Israel, following after the law of righteousness, didn't arrive at the law of righteousness. Why? Because they didn't seek it by faith. It doesn't say that they didn't attain righteousness because they were trying to obey the law. That's not what it says. It simply says it's because they didn't mix it with faith. Confirmation of that is in Hebrews chapter 4, verses 1 and 2. Hebrews 4, 1 and 2. It says that the Israelites in the wilderness were preached the same gospel that we, the apostles, are preaching right now. The same gospel, the same good news. The only difference is they did not mix the word that they heard with faith. They stumbled over the stumbling stone. Okay, Luke chapter 2, verse 34. Even as it is written, behold, I lay in Zion a stumbling stone and a rock of offense, and no one who believes in him will be disappointed. We got tons of scriptures here. Psalm 22, 5. Mark 12, 10. Luke 20, verse 17. Psalms 118, verse 22, Acts 4:11. I mean, tons of cross-references there. Okay, guys, that's Romans chapter 9. I feel like, who is it, Peter, that was preaching all night, and the guy fell out the window? Yeah, Paul? It's probably Paul. I hope nobody falls out a window, okay? Because I got energy right now. I've been holding this all Shabbat. I've been holding all this in all Shabbat. So I'm going to let this all out right now. This whole, I'm going to keep on going. Next chapter. Brothers and sisters, so chapter 9 of Romans is about Israel and is about the remnant of Israel. More specifically, the remnant of Israel being saved. Romans chapter 10. Brothers, my heart's desire, my prayer to Elohim is for Israel, that they may be saved. He's reminding us, Paul is just reminding you guys, I'm not preaching a different good news here. I'm not preaching a different kingdom. I'm not preaching a different bride. I'm not preaching a different people. I'm not preaching a different remnant. I'm not preaching a different message. In case you guys are getting confused with what I'm saying. Verse 2. For I testify about them that they have a zeal for Elohim, but not according to knowledge. For being ignorant of Elohim's righteousness and seeking to establish their own righteousness, that means that they have their own laws and their own commandments and their own traditions. That's called the Talmud. Okay, if you look up in Judaism today, they have what's called the Talmud. It's a bunch of added traditions and doctrines of men. I got people coming up to me saying, Happy New Year, brother, Happy New Year's. It's not Happy New Year. It ain't no Happy New Year. It's Feast of Trumpets. It is Feast of Trumpets, not Happy New Year. I'm sorry, that is a tradition of man. And you got Christianity filled with doctrines and traditions of man. Judaism and Christianity, both of them are filled with doctrines and traditions of man. We need to come into the middle and just follow what's already been written in Scripture. Let's just keep it simple, stupid, please. Keep it simple, stupid. I used to have a manager in sales that said, just keep it simple, stupid. Don't get too complicated when you're trying to sell something to somebody. Just keep it simple, stupid. Okay? I'm like, yes, okay. Keep it simple, stupid, okay. All right. So these Israelites have a zeal for knowledge, but not according to Elohim, not according to knowledge, the right knowledge. For being ignorant of Yahuwah's righteousness and seeking to establish their own righteousness, they didn't subject themselves to the righteousness of Elohim. For Messiah is the fulfillment of the Torah for righteousness to everyone who believes. So many Christians destroy and jack up and twist this verse right here. If I haven't made it clear already, the Messiah came not to destroy the law. He actually commanded his disciples to obey the law of Moses. And in Matthew 28, he actually told his disciples to go and make disciples of all nations, teaching them to obey all that he commanded. So it can't be saying what you think it's saying. Here's what it says. For Messiah is the fulfillment of the Torah, or the completion, or the end, or the goal. Okay, the goal. That word, that Greek word there, could also, I heard this, you guys could look this up for yourself, okay? But that Greek word that's here is used for, is the end, okay? In some scriptures it say is the end of the law, okay? Telos. Look up the word telos. From what I heard, and this makes sense to me, telos is almost like using the example of an arrow, okay? A bone arrow and an arrow. The actual arrow at the tip has the, whatever the heck it's called, the triangle tip of it, where the end of that arrow is the tip. That's the end. Everything is pointing to that. Okay? Just because that's the end of the arrow doesn't mean you chop off the other piece of the arrow. It ain't gonna do you no good. No, everything lines up with the tip of the point of that arrow. Everything lines up. So in the same way, this is saying that the Messiah is the epitome of righteousness. He is the epitome. He is the perfect, exact representation of set-apartness and righteousness. He is the best example we have ever had on planet Earth, manifested as a man in the flesh. He is the perfect example because he completed, he fulfilled, he accomplished, he obeyed the law of Moses perfectly till death. Okay? So he is our example. That's what it's saying here, guys. It is not saying that the law is done away with. If you believe in Messiah, the law doesn't exist anymore. Okay? that can be true if you interpret that correctly, meaning you're not bound by the consequences and the punishments of the law if you're actually walking in the spirit of the Messiah, if you're actually being faithful and obedient. Yeah, then the consequences and the law, the consequences and the punishments of the law won't have any jurisdiction over you. That's what it means. The law for righteousness to everyone who believes. Verse 5, for Moses writes about the righteousness of the law. The one who does them will live by them. Leviticus chapter 18, verse 5. Nehemiah 9:29. Leviticus 18:5. Ezekiel 20, verse 11. Okay. The one who does them will live by them. So there is a righteousness of the law. I want to prepare a message in the future about that. I'm going to talk about the righteousness of the law and the righteousness of faith. I don't think one is just, you know, doing away with the other. They both work together. They can't oppose one another. You can't have the righteousness of the law apart from faith. You can't have it. It won't work. As you already have seen, it didn't work with the Israelites in the Old Testament. Even if you don't have the New Testament, you can see that through the Old Testament, they didn't have faith. They were called unfaithful prostitutes. They were called whoremongers by the Messiah, by the prophets. They were unfaithful, like an unfaithful, stubborn wife. That's what the prophets preached. Israel was very stubborn and rebellious that way. So they didn't have faith. They didn't have circumcised hearts. That's all over the Torah and the prophets. It's all over the Old Testament. It's all over the Tanakh. Okay? This is not a new subject. Faith and the law, obedience to the law, have to come together. Verse 6 of Romans 10. But the righteousness which is of faith says this, don't say in your heart, who will ascend into heaven? And then in parentheses it says, that is to bring the Messiah down. Or who will descend into the abyss? That is to bring the Messiah up from the dead. But what does it say? The word is near you, in your mouth and in your heart. That is the word of faith which we preach. That if you will confess with your mouth that Yahushua is the Master, is the Lord, is Adonai, whatever you want to say, and believe in your heart that Elohim raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Paul is quoting from Deuteronomy chapter 30, verses 12 to 14, which is the time that the law of Moses was given. And in that same chapter of Deuteronomy 30, Israel is commanded to obey all of the law that is written in the book. It didn't just say the Ten Commandments. It says all that is written in this book. Deuteronomy 30 is all about that Yahuwah brings life and death. He brings before them life and death, blessing and cursing. Choose life. So Paul is affirming the law of Moses and faith, but he's specifically emphasizing faith. When you believe in your heart, you believe the words that Yahuwah is preaching, you believe the words that he is teaching, you believe the words that he's given, and he's even if he's using a human being, the words that are coming from him through that human being and being spoken to you, you believe it and say, I will do everything that you say. That is faith. That's faith. Before you even keep all those commandments, you already decided in your heart and in your mind, I'm going to obey everything that the Creator is telling me. That's faith. But doing is works. So Paul is emphasizing faith right now. He is putting faith in its proper place first, number one. But he's not neglecting the law of Moses. Otherwise, he would not be quoting the law of Moses. Hopefully that makes sense. Romans 10. For with the heart one believes. With the heart, with the mind and the heart, one believes, resulting in righteousness, And with the mouth, confession is made, resulting in salvation. You got to confess. You got to confess him as master. You got to confess him, you know, confess your sins. You know, that's what helps the process of you becoming a righteous child of the Creator. Verse 11, for the scripture says, whoever believes in him will not be disappointed. Isaiah 28:16. And, Verse 12, for there is no distinction between Jew or Greek. There's no distinction. They both have to come through the same door. They have to come through Messiah. He is the way, the truth, and the life. No man can come to the Father but by him. Yahushua Messiah. He is the door. He is the way in. For the Jews, for the Israelites, he's the way back in. Because they used to be in. But they got kicked out. But he's the way back in. For the same master, for the same Yahuwah, is master of all and is rich to all who call on him. For whoever will call on the name of Yahuwah will be saved. That is so essential, guys. Joel chapter 2, verse 32. It says, it will happen that whoever will call on Yahuwah's name shall be saved. For in Mount Zion and in Jerusalem there will be those who escape, as Yahuwah has said, and among the remnant those whom Yahuwah calls. Who's the remnant? The remnant is Israel. Israel. Not Christianity. It is Israel. It is a law, faithful, abiding, obedient people. Kingdom of priests. Set apart. Chosen. Peculiar. Joel chapter 2 says the name of the Father. In your Bible it will say the Lord. But in the Hebrew, it's the tetragrammaton. It's the YHUH. But we see in the New Testament that you got to call upon the Son. See, and that's where you got to understand the name of the Father and the Son are together. And his remnant, Israel, will receive that. My sheep hear my voice. That's what the Messiah said. My sheep hear my voice. And he's the lawgiver. Okay, Romans 10. The name of the Messiah, by the way, the reason why I say Yahusha is because Yahusha means Yah saves, simply. Husha, the word Husha, that's the name that was Joshua, the son of Nun, before his name was changed to Joshua. You'll see in the King James or in another translation, might say Hosea or Hosea. That's how you'll see it. But that name in the Hebrew is Husha. And all Moses did was he added a yod to the beginning of his name and made it Yahusha. So his name already meant salvation. And it just added a yod, a Y, to the beginning of his name to make it Yahusha, for Yah saves. Okay, the root word to Husha and Yahusha is the word Yasha, which also means salvation. So it's filled with the Father's name. And the Father's name, as you guys know, I'm very big on. That's why I decided to choose my website name and everything devoted to Yah, is because that's the short version of the Father's name. And it's found in the phrases we use, like hallelujah. We all say hallelujah, which means praise Yah. It's found in many names of prophets, of many characters in the scriptures. Whenever you see the letters J-E or I-A-H, that's Yah. It's really Yah in the Hebrew. And so it's imperative. You know, the name of the Father is in the name of the Son. And I don't accept any other message than that. Romans 10, verse 14, this is important. How then will they call on him whom they have not believed? How will they believe in him whom they have not heard? How will they hear without a preacher? You see, guys, that's what I'm doing right now. I'm preaching that way. And if you guys share this video with anyone, they're getting this word, so they're without excuse. They're not going to hear this message in their Christian church. Your pastor is not going to teach this message because he is ignorant of this. But if he ever comes across this message, he is held accountable. And if he decides to preach against it, condemnation and wrath be upon him all the days of his life, unless he repents. Verse 15, and how will they preach unless they are sent? You have to be sent by the Ruach HaKodesh. You have to be called. As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the good news of peace. This is a message of peace, guys. I'm trying to be a peacemaker. I'm trying to make peace between you and your maker. Which, if you are not obeying his commandments, if you are not mixing your faith with obedience to his commandments, to his laws and statutes, to the law of Moses, you have wrath abiding upon you. Or I'll be fair, because again, people can be saved despite understanding the fact that they have to keep the law of Moses. It's very possible. But here's the thing. If you claim that you want to obey the word, the whole word, that the word of the Almighty is your bread. Man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of Yahuwah. If you believe that, but the message that I'm preaching to you right now, if you're not receiving it after all the scriptures I've been showing you, if you start to resist the law of Moses, despite the evidence that I'm giving you, you have wrath and condemnation upon you. You have a carnal mind, just like Romans chapter 8 says. A carnal mind cannot please Elohim. You're not pleasing to him. You are not a pleasing aroma. You're not a pleasing sacrifice of praise. He is not receiving it. Now, if you're ignorant, that might be different. If you've never heard this message, you were in the safe zone. I call it the safe zone. But if you're hearing this message right now, you're not in the safe zone. You're in a danger zone right now, because now you have a choice whether to obey this message or reject this message, and violently reject this message. Some people stay quiet so that they can go back into their closet and study. I respect that, and that's what you should do. But then you have two other groups. You have one group that starts to make videos and YouTube videos and teachings to come against the law of Moses and all of us who are obeying the Messiah and the law of Moses at the same time. And then you have the other group who is extreme about it. I mean, they are violently, violently against the law of Moses. Very dangerous place to be. Very dangerous place to be. Romans chapter 10, verse 16. But they didn't all listen to the good news, to the gospel. For Isaiah says, Yahuwah, who has believed our report? Look at that, guys. The word gospel is the word good news. It's the word glad tidings, evangel. It's the same, that same word has been used all throughout the Old Testament. The problem is that our translators have intentionally chosen different words from the Old Testament to the New Testament to throw you off and to make you think that the good news of the New Testament is completely different from the good news of the Old Testament. It is a deliberate, intentional error. Intentional. Just like they did the same word with the word church. Since we're talking about Israel, who the chosen people are, the chosen people is the congregation and the assembly of Israel. The word church simply means congregation and assembly. But the reason why the translators have chosen to put church instead of congregation or assembly is to throw you off and to make you think that the Christian church is the chosen people of God. But as I've been showing you so far, that is not the case. The congregation is Israel, has been Israel, is Israel, and will always be the remnant of Israel. If you obey and keep his commandments, if you have faith and obey his commandments. So, oh, by the way, Romans chapter 10, verse 16 is a quote from Isaiah 53, verse 1. Verse 17 of Romans 10 says, so, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of Elohim. This is what Paul emphasizes. Faith comes. comes by hearing. So when true believers, when those who are being called out, those who are being awakened, hear good teaching, good solid scriptural teaching, and their hearts get stirred up and they get drawn, that's because they have faith. But woe unto those that violently reject the word. Verse 18, but I say, didn't they hear? Talking about the Israelites? Yes, most certainly. Their sound went out into all the earth, their words to the ends of the world. But I ask, didn't Israel know? First, Moses says, I will provoke you to jealousy with that which is no nation. I will make you angry with a nation void of understanding. That's very important. And a lot of people take that passage and say, oh, you see, it's not about Israel anymore. Now it's about the Gentiles, the Christian church. We're the ones that are making the Jews jealous, and they're going to want to be like us. No. No. That's a quote from Deuteronomy chapter 32, verse 21. If we read it, it says, they have moved me to jealousy with that which is not Elohim. They have provoked me to anger with their vanities. I will move them to jealousy with those who are not a people. I will provoke them to anger with a foolish nation. The whole context of Deuteronomy 32 is about sending nations to violently persecute the Israelites. Verse 20, Isaiah is very bold and says, I was found by those who didn't seek me. I was revealed to those who didn't ask for me. Isaiah 65, verse 1. But about Israel, he says, all day long I stretch out my hands to a disobedient and contrary people. Isaiah 65, verse 2. Do you see how Paul is showing the extravagant love that the Father has for his people Israel? He is begging for obedience from Israel. That's his bride. What good man would be happy with a disobedient wife? What good man would... You must be a very complacent, nonchalant man if you don't care that your wife is disobedient, rebellious, and stubborn, and contentious. You're just different, and that's why your house is all jacked up. So Isaiah, verse 20 and 21... or 19 all the way to 21. This is talking about Gentiles who will provoke them to jealousy. They'll be provoked by people who are not a people to get right, to get their life right. Now, if you want to take that message, take it however you want. If you consider being persecuted by America and you're not, you know, being discriminated against because of your skin color and all that, fine. Take that. Get motivated. Get right. If you want to take that as you know, this is part of the consequence because we're Israelites, you know, those of us of color, fine, whatever. But people who are white are Israelites as well. And again, it's not about skin color. This is about the circumcision of the heart. This is about being born again. This is about going through the door, which is Yahushua the Messiah. So regardless of your skin color, if you don't repent from breaking the law of Moses, and you don't have faith in the Father and in the Son, you cannot get into the kingdom. Last chapter, very important of Romans. Very, very important. Romans 11, verse 1. I ask then. So I'm asking this question in light of chapter 9 and 10. After all that I've said thus far, I'm going to ask this question. Did Elohim reject his people? Who are his people that we've been talking about in the last two chapters? Israel. Paul asks the question, and he answers his own question. He says, may it never be. Never, ever, ever. Elohim forbid. For I also, me, Paul, Shaul, I am an Israelite, a descendant of Abraham, of the tribe of Benjamin. Elohim didn't reject his people, which he foreknew, foreknowledge, election, everything that we've been talking about in chapter 9 that the Calvinists think is about Christianity. No, the election and the foreknowledge is about Israel, the remnant. So Elohim did not reject his people, which he foreknew. Or don't you know what the scripture says about Elijah? How he pleads with Elohim against Yisrael? Yahuwah, they have killed your prophets. They have broken down your altars. I am left alone and they seek my life. 1 Kings chapter 19, verse 10. 1 Kings 19, verse 14. But how does Elohim answer him? I have reserved myself 7,000 men who have not bowed the knee to Baal. Hallelujah. 1 Kings 19, 18. Even so, then, at this present time, also there is a remnant according to the election of grace. And if by grace, then it is no longer of works, otherwise grace is no longer grace. But if it is of works, it is no longer grace, otherwise work is no longer work. Again, guys, Paul is not against work. That is foolishness. He is simply trying to bring faith and works and put them in their proper places. Faith first and works second. You cannot have works first and be void of faith. Okay? You can't even have faith second. Okay? If you're keeping the commandments for ill intentions, if you're trying to be holy and trying to keep the commandments and be set apart for the sake of being looked at well by other people, you're trying to be a pleaser of man, that's pride. Okay, that's pride. That's what the Pharisees and Sadducees did. And you see that all over Christianity. Not every Christian church is like this, but most of the churches you see like this. Pastors get special parking. Pastors get a special seat to sit on the altar. They get a big, nice chair. They get this big, nice ring, big robe, and some people kiss it and bow down to them. I mean, sick, sick, sick things that if you're not reading your scriptures, you'll have no problem with it. Well, actually, I know some unbelievers who actually can see the issue with that. People who don't even believe in the Bible, they're like, yeah, that's just stupid. I wouldn't be bowing down kissing nobody's ring. Romans 11. For if by grace, then it is no longer works. He's focusing on grace and faith. That's what he's focusing on. Verse 7. What then? That which Israel seeks. That which Israel seeks for, that he didn't obtain, but the chosen ones obtained it, and the rest were hardened. Okay? Talking about the remnant of Yisrael. Verse 8, according as it is written, Elohim gave them a spirit of stupor, eyes that they should not see, and ears that they should not hear, to this very day. Deuteronomy 29, verse 4, Isaiah 29, 10. David says, let their table be made a snare, a trap, a stumbling block, and a retribution to them. Let their eyes be darkened that they may not see. Always keep their backs bent. Psalm 69, verse 22 and 23. Verse 11 of Romans 11. I ask then, did they, the Israelites, stumble that they might fall? Some translations say that they might fall beyond recovery. I love that. Because that's what it's talking about. Yes, they have fallen, but are they unable to get up? No, may it never be. But by their fall, salvation has come to the Gentiles to provoke them to jealousy. It has come to those who were never Israelites and to those who were cut off of covenant relationship, the house of Israel and all the other Israelites who were disobedient and stiff-necked and rebellious. Verse 12, now if their fall is the riches of the world and their loss the riches of the Gentiles, how much more their fullness? Now, if their fall is the riches of the world, meaning it's glorious, it's rich, how much more rich will their fullness be when they're actually restored, the Israelites? It's context, guys. Verse 13, for I speak to you who are Gentiles. Since then, as I am an apostle to the Gentiles, I glorify my ministry. Okay, a little boastful. Verse 14, if by any means I may provoke to jealousy those who are my flesh. We're hearing that word provoke to jealousy again. and may save some of them. So Shaul, an Israelite, is trying to provoke to jealousy his own Israelite brothers to this faith. For if the rejection of them, the stubborn, rebellious Israelites, is the reconciling of the world, what would their acceptance be but life from the dead? Verse 16, if the first fruit is set apart, so is the lump. If the root is set apart, so are the branches. But if some of the branches were broken off, and you, being a wild olive, were grafted in among them and became partaker with them of the root and of the richness of the olive tree, don't boast over the branches. I used to believe that it said, you a wild branch. But it's not saying a wild branch. It says an olive. A wild olive is being grafted in to the natural olive tree. You're not even a branch. You're an olive. And you're being grafted in to an Israelite tree with Israelite branches and Israelite olives. What do you think is going to happen when you get grafted in? The same thing that happened when Gentiles joined themselves to Israel all over the Old Testament. They become one with Israel. They become as an Israelite. They become a native born. They embrace the same law. They embrace the same commandments, the same statutes. And it says, you, little olive, Mr. Gentile, don't boast over the branches. But if you boast, it is not you who support the root, but the root supports you. Again, just know who got you there and know who's sustaining all of your essential nutrition. The Father is the one that sustains us. Verse 19, you will say then, branches were broken off that I might be grafted in. Verse 20, that's true. But if their unbelief, by their unbelief, they were broken off and you stand by your faith, don't be conceited, but fear. For if Elohim didn't spare the natural branches, neither will he spare you. Who are the natural branches? Israel. Israel is the natural branch. We cannot, you can't ignore that, and you can't preach something else from that. And he's bringing an example. If he didn't spare them, then he's not going to spare you if you act the same way. If you're stiff-necked and you embrace traditions and doctrines of man, he's not going to spare you. You need to let your traditions and doctrines go. Let them go. Leave them alone. You don't need them. They're additional burdens to you. Even in the Messianic movement, they're still embracing some of the Talmud. Let it go. Let it go, man. Let it go. You don't need it. It's unnecessary. There's enough in the scriptures that we have right now that we need to occupy ourselves with. No need to keep adding. There's enough already. Verse 22, see then the goodness and severity of Elohim toward those who fell, severity, but towards you, goodness. If you continue in his goodness, otherwise you also will be cut off. You see, it's a warning. Learn from the Israelite, rebellious Israelites. 23, they also, if they don't continue in their unbelief, will be grafted back in. For Elohim is able to graft them in again. So if they repent and they turn from their sin and turn to the Messiah, if they're born again, if they're immersed in the name of Yahusha, HaMashiach, hallelujah, blessed is he who comes in the name of Yahuwah, then they will be grafted back in. Verse 24, for if you were cut out of that which is by nature a wild olive tree and were grafted a contrary to the nature into a good olive tree, how much more will these which are the natural branches be grafted into their own olive tree again? Again, my question is, what's the tree? It's Israel. I've debated with so many Christians about this. They swear up and down that the tree is righteousness. It's not Israel, it's just righteousness. And so people who are grafted in and they're declared righteous, children that are righteous. That is partially true. Contextually false. Contextually wrong. In context to Romans chapter 9, 10, and 11. It's partially true. Yes, you are declared righteous, but you're also grafted into Israel. You have become Israel, whom the Messiah came to save, whom the Messiah came to be a king of, whom the Messiah came to be a shepherd of, whom the Messiah came to be the glory of. That's what I'm preaching. Romans 11, verse 25, "For I don't desire you to be ignorant, brothers, of this mystery, so that you won't be wise in your own understanding, that a partial hardening has happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles has come in." This is very important. There is a scripture in the Old Testament that I don't have with me right now, but it's, I want to say, during Jacob laying his hands on Manasseh and Ephraim. And he says that Ephraim will be the fullness of the nations. And if you look up that word, fullness of the nations, it's goyim, which is also translated as Gentiles. This is prophetic. How else can the Gentiles come in? If we were waiting for the Messiah to return all the way in the future to restore the kingdom literally, to bring the nations and the Gentiles in, man, that sucks, because that means right now none of us as Gentiles can be saved. So that's why I don't believe in this non-New Testament, non-Brit Hadashah Israelite camp. Okay, I don't believe in Judaism. I don't believe in Karaite Jews. Okay, I appreciate a lot of things they teach, but they're going to hell. They're going to the lake of fire. I'm sorry. I mean, it's just, that's just what it is. They're lost. I had a good brother who used to be on my Facebook who went that route. And this man, his wife, was healed from lupus in a messianic Hebrew Israelite congregation. Delivered. I mean, they said demons were coming out of her. And those demons were connected to the lupus. And she went back and got her doctor's papers, healed. Healed from lupus. That's what Matthew was talking about when it says, "Many will say to me, Master, Master, Lord, Lord, or Yahuwah, Yahuwah. Haven't we done miracles and things in your name?" And they still depart. That's crazy. You've been healed in the name of the Messiah, and you reject him now. You were healed from lupus. Your wife was healed from lupus, and you do not believe in the Messiah anymore. That's crazy. If that's not delusion, what? If I had a wife that had lupus and she was healed from it in the name of the Messiah? I don't care what name you used. And they used Jesus. They're a Hebrew Israelite congregation. Straightway ministry. I'll call them out right now. I'll give a little props, a little respect. Straightway. Charles Dow, Pastor Dow. You know, I don't agree with everything that guy says. I don't agree with everything that come out of that ministry. But listen, that happened. And you have to be an idiot not to at least acknowledge that. They pray for healing. They pray to get demons cast out of people. Where's your faith to do that? So this woman was healed from lupus, and they do not believe in the New Testament anymore. That's crazy. Woof. I couldn't do it. Couldn't pay me enough money. So, for the fullness of the nations to come in. I'm sorry I don't have that passage right now. but it's regarding Ephraim and Manasseh. Genesis 48 or something, my wife is saying. It's around there somewhere. Romans 11, 26. And so all Israel will be saved. You see that summary right there? When the fullness of the Gentiles come in, all Israel will be saved. They're telling you right there in two verses that Gentiles are being grafted into Israel. And the goal is for Israel to be saved. Powerful. Powerful. Who are you, Christian? Who's your king? What does that make you? What kingdom are you part of? Verse 26, even as it is written, there will come out of Zion the deliverer, and he will turn away ungodliness from Jacob. Another word for ungodliness is, and he will turn away wickedness from Jacob. Let's look up that word Zion just for the fun of it. Let's see what the concordance says Zion is. It says a parched place, the hill on which the higher and more ancient part of Jerusalem was built. The southwestmost and highest of the hills on which the city was built. Often used of the entire city of Jerusalem. Since Jerusalem, because the temple stood there, was called the dwelling place of Elohim. Guys, salvation is for Israel. You got to get this message. Genesis 48. Chapter 48. Do you know the verse at all?
I think that's a 14.
Starts around verse 14 is about Ephraim and Manasseh and about the prophecy about the fullness of the nations. Okay? Man, Romans 11, 26, powerful. There will come out of Zion. Zion's in Yerushalayim. Zion is not in the empire of Christianity. Zion.